that might be civil engineering. You know, throw up the bridge quickly across the river, using what's to hand. No, it's of course all about military discipline. And this is real, this is not invented. The University of Minnesota, at least at one point, offered a course in mortuary science. This meant the art of making the corpses look good. This honorific usage makes it terribly easy to forget certain simple truths. First of all, not all scientists are good inquirers. Some of them are stupid, some of them are careless, and some of them are dishonest. And probably some are all three. Moreover, not only scientists are good inquirers. There are plenty of good inquirers in history, in literature, in the law, even in philosophy. It also makes it awfully easy to dismiss bad science as not really science at all, which, of course, encourages the first conviction. And it makes it very easy to assume that if it isn't science, then it's no good. Or at any rate, it's not as good as if it were science. Or most unfortunately. Because, okay, how do I say this? The best scientific work is a great human cognitive achievement, without a doubt. I don't know if any of you have ever read it, but there is a very famous paper written by Oswald Avery and his collaborators in the 1940s, describing the experiments by which he determined that DNA is the genetic material. This is now a very familiar fact to us, but if you read the details of what he had to do to show this, you can't help but be impressed by it. You're proud to be a human being. Hey, we can do this. This is really impressive. Still, even the best scientific work is horrible. Even Newton's work turned out to have limitations. There's plenty of good work in other fields. There's also plenty of useful knowledge accumulated by people who are not sort of official inquirers at all. Like, you think of farmers, shipbuilders, practitioners of traditional medicine, and so on. I think this honorific usage also encourages uncritical credulity, I mean, just falling for it too easily, about even very speculative new science. I don't know if this happens in your newspapers, but in the newspapers I read, every week there's some brilliant breakthrough announced, and about 90% of these turn out to be, in the end, just a mistake. And if you tried to follow their advice about what to eat, you would go crazy. Because you should eat eggs this week, and then you mustn't go near an egg next week. In fact, there is at this point, as I see it, a very large body of very well-warranted scientific knowledge. But this is what remains of a vast trashy of stuff that didn't work out. So most of what people come up with at the cutting edge will turn out to be wrong. 2% of it will turn out to be right and really important. The 1% of it will last forever and will become part of the textbooks. But we shouldn't forget the trashy. It's very important, the trashy. Okay, second sign. Borrow tools and techniques. Actually, even in the sciences themselves, the apparatus is sometimes just decoration. Let me give you a simple, quite simple example. There was a lot of epidemiological work done on a drug called Vendectin. Probably sold here, but probably under another name. It does prevent morning sickness in pregnancy. So a useful drug in that perspective. but it was suspected of causing limb reduction birth defects in some of the babies who were born, or women who took the drug. Well, if you look at those epidemiological studies, which I have because they're legally very important, Dalbert was a case about Vendexin, it turns out a lot of them made no distinction between women who took the drug during the period of pregnancy when the limbs were forming, and women who took it later. So you've got all sorts of elaborate mathematical apparatus, but underlying it is just a huge mistake which invalidates all the research. Of course, it's even worse in the social sciences. I wanted to make the point, it happens in the natural sciences, but it's worse in the social sciences. Here is my favorite example. A sociologist called David Abramson, and this is the second law of criminal behavior. The criminal act is the sum of a person's criminalistic tendencies plus his social situation divided by the amount of his resistance. Or C equals T plus S over R. It's complete nonsense dressed up as mathematics. By the way, I don't think philosophy is immune to scientism. I hadn't better talk about this at too great length, but it makes me furious when philosophy journals adopt the name, date, page number citation system used in the social sciences. If you're trying to do something historical, this is impossible. That just makes a complete mess of it. But it's scientific, so we do it that way. I think peer-reviewed publication works even less well the more a field is a field of cliques and schools, which philosophy certainly is at the moment. And while technical terminology is very useful in philosophy, I've invented a few myself, it's often a sham. It's not really doing any work, it doesn't mean anything. But you don't dare ask, because it's a technical term. I don't mean to say, I really am a moderate, this is not to say all borrowed tools are inappropriate. Sometimes they are, sometimes they aren't. Here are three very interesting examples where scientific tools turned out to be really useful. Historians had old printed Bibles, very old printed Bibles. Didn't know either how old they were exactly, or who printed them. They borrowed a cyclotron from the physics department. I think it was an old cyclotron, out of date, presumably a good one. They were able to determine the composition of the ink and to discover that these Bibles were both printed by Gutenberg, but both were earlier than the Gutenberg Bible. Second example, it was a big scandal in the United States a few years ago, prompted by a book which claimed that Thomas Jefferson, was the father of the seven children of one of his house slaves.